Thank you so much, Wes. And before we do anything, I'm going to ask that special group to stand again by themselves, including Hoffy, member of the cadet nurse program, who is, in my estimation, part of the war effort. So would all the World War II veterans please stand? I didn't even have to ask you to applaud them, because just like Wes said, these people, each in their own particular way, helped to save the world, and they saved it for us. What I'm hoping to share with you tonight is the background of why we're here tonight on December 7, 2016, exactly 75 years after the attack. Before we start looking at the pictures and hearing a few things, I have to tell you that we have to go back 10 years before Pearl Harbor to understand what happened. It's not generally known that the Japanese Empire was at war for more than 10 years before they decided to attack us. It was in September of 1931 that they invaded China. Can you imagine invading a country like China, a huge country like that? The Japanese soldiers, who underwent the most rigorous and cruel training, went into China, and they became, you might say, terrorists in their own time. Those soldiers in China made ISIS look like sissies. The things that they did, I won't even mention. Just read the book, Rape of Nanking, and it will change your opinion forever. They were allowed to do anything they wanted to do. As a government program, initiated by somebody you'll meet in a minute, and it was an official program to make sure that the Chinese people as a whole would not resist. If you demonstrate strongly enough and cruelly enough with every unspeakable atrocity possible, then the next town you come to, people will submit. That's the same policy that we have going on in the Middle East now, in places like Aleppo and other places where ISIS is. So there's nothing new under the sun. What happened back in 1931 was actually the beginning of what led to, of course, World War II. The man you see on the screen here reminds me of what today is. Today we heard on the news that Time has picked somebody for the person of the year. Well, if you go back to 1945, here is somebody who made a big effect on the world. Of course, Adolf Hitler did too, and others did. So we don't always pick somebody who is so wonderful. Emperor Hirohito was born in 1901. So when Japan attacked China, he was only 30 years old. He had been raised as a child, being told and believing that he was the son of heaven. In other words, he came directly from God, and it was his destiny to help Japan take over the world. And they did a good job of it for a while. It took over a huge area, and they made the Pacific Ocean a Japanese lake. We'll see how that developed 75 years ago today, the reason for it, and some other information. Here's another man who is very vital in this whole program. His name is Isoriko Yamamoto. He lived in the United States for quite a few years as a young man. He learned about America. He was educated here. When he went back to Japan, he became very high in the Navy. And he was the man who was given the job of organizing the attack on Pearl Harbor, which had been planned many, many months earlier, of course, in secret. He did not agree with the plan, but he could not say no to the emperor. He was a great military man. Nobody can argue with that. And he followed his orders. He set up everything. And after the attack, he said several things. One of the things he said was, "We will be able to run wild for about 6 months." Well, what comes after that? He knew. He knew that America could not be beaten. He knew that the industrial might of our country would carry the day. And he was exactly correct when he said 6 months, because 6 months, almost to the exact day, the turning point of the war happened at the Battle of Midway, where America finally got things going and stopped being defeated and turned into the aggressor. We'll get to that a little bit later. Yamamoto also said, after the attack was done, probably just about this time, that day, on the way back to Japan, he said, "I fear that all we have done is to awaken a sleeping giant and fill him with a terrible resolve." He knew what was coming, and pretty soon everybody else did too. Here is the map. The famous battleship row. Everything was lined up, and there were Japanese spies in Hawaii who made sure that the word got back to Japan, which battleships, which other ships were there, where they were located, so they were sitting ducks. The only big flaw in their plan was the aircraft carriers were not there. They were out on the ocean, so they could not be damaged. Battleship row, you see, every ship that has the name of a state is a battleship. They were all attacked, and three of them were put completely out of commission and destroyed. The ones that were damaged all got back into action within a year and a half. So just an amazing result of American ingenuity. They didn't just attack the battleships. They attacked other ships, plus the airplanes, the airports, the fields. They didn't go for their third wave, however. There were two waves of airplanes coming in, and they decided that's enough. If they had come back for the third time, they could have destroyed the fuel depots. They could have destroyed other facilities that were not touched at all. So that's one of the mistakes that the Japanese made on that day, fortunately. This is a ship that's very little known. It's called the USS Ward. It's a destroyer. And on that particular morning, early in the morning, this ship was doing patrol duty right at the entrance of Pearl Harbor. I'm going to tell you something that not everybody knows. We fired the first shot of World War II. And it happened an hour before the first Japanese planes came in. This ship was on patrol, and they saw a periscope. And this periscope was following a US Navy ship into Pearl Harbor. So they never hesitated. They blasted it, and it sank. Turns out it was a midget submarine. And here's a real one that's preserved. And by the way, when they surrendered, the Japanese had 80 of these ready to go in case we invaded. And hundreds of aircraft for the kamikaze that were planned in case we invaded. Thank God we never had to invade that country. The submarine sank. It's a two-man submarine, and the whole plan was to get five of those into Pearl Harbor so that during the attack, each one could fire its torpedo into one of the ships. One of those submarines did make it. It fired a torpedo into the West Virginia, but of course that one was destroyed. With a gun like this from the USS Ward, this is the actual gun that fired the first shot, the first American shot in World War II, 1 hour before the attack started. Now, 1 hour isn't much time, so they didn't have a lot of time to get the word to the people who needed to know that something was up. But the people on that ship knew it. And this man's name is Will Lehner. I was so fortunate to meet him 5 years ago in Wisconsin. Somebody tipped me off. I was visiting over there, and they said, you should really meet this man. He was on the ship. And by an amazing coincidence, about 2 hours ago, he was on the radio, 95 years old. Will Lehner is still living. I'm going to call him tomorrow and tell him he was the star of the show tonight. You can see him here as a young man, and you can see him here as an older man showing a model of the submarine that his ship sank. So if you think the Japanese started it, no, we did something before the attack. And a complete coincidence here. Here is the USS Ward just before it sank on December 7, 1944. So it was a casualty of the Japanese 3 years later to the day. And here's the picture everybody has seen, the US Arizona going down. The ship was completely destroyed. And of course, as you'll see, it's still there today. The battleships. At that time, the battleship was the main Navy weapon. And I love this picture. It's kind of scary to look at. Imagine them coming at you. It's an amazing ship, but it became somewhat obsolete during World War II. When the kamikazes would try to attack American ships, they'd fly right past the battleships heading for their main targets, the aircraft carriers, which became and now, of course, are the main part of the US Navy. So the battleships, they were used in later wars for basically just bombarding the shore. They were used in the Iraq War. How many of you have been here? Okay. I picked this picture because it shows the actual ship, it shows the memorial, and of course you can see the oil trailing from it. It's trailing from it right now today, after all these years. It's a reminder that there are 1,177 men who are entombed there. Out of the 2,400 people who were killed, mostly military, there are 980 who were never identified. Not these fellas. We know who they are. They're still in their ship. The ones who were never identified were pretty much completely burned up, because every time a ship was hit, the oil from that ship would spill out into the harbor. There was a thick layer of oil on the water. So you're blown off the ship, you go right into flaming oil. That's how horrible that day was for America. In the last few days, I've asked a lot of veterans, how did you get the news? So I've heard lots of stories. Some got it riding in a car because of the radio. Some got it sitting at home with their parents. And each one has their own story, just like we have our own story about the assassination and, of course, more recently, 9/11. Those are the two events, 9/11 and Pearl Harbor, where we were attacked on our own property by the enemy. And we'll never forget. You're inside the memorial here. It's very quiet there. It's a sacred place. And if anybody speaks up, they're reminded this is a sacred place. Here are the 1,177 names of the people who are on that ship today. Most of the crew was lost. There are only a few survivors left today. Only five, in fact, if you looked at the Muskegon Chronicle today. Now, this picture shows the beginning of the war, the Arizona Memorial, and it shows the USS Missouri, which has been more recently added, and that's where the Japanese signed the surrender documents. So this symbolic position of these two represents the beginning and the end of the war. Anybody know why Elvis is in here? This American soldier gave a concert specifically designed to help support the Arizona Memorial. In fact, he paid for more than 10% of the memorial himself. This is one of the greatest friendships in world history. Our President FDR and Winston Churchill, who, by the way, was half American. His mother was an American person. They got together many times during the war because Britain was hanging on by its fingernails. Britain was almost beaten by the Germans, and Winston Churchill was desperate to get some help. We helped them with the Lend-Lease Act, where we would lend them ships and other equipment, but we Americans wanted nothing to do with other people's wars. We had been stung terribly in World War I. We wanted no part of two Asian cultures fighting each other. We wanted no part of Europe again. Even when Britain was going down, we were watching baseball games and having fun and living our American life, knowing we had these two oceans protecting us. And then along came Pearl Harbor. Winston Churchill said, after I heard the news, I slept that night like a baby. He was very happy. And of course, Roosevelt was a mixture of feelings. He was outraged, of course. And then he was happy also because finally, we had a chance to help out. I've met a few of the Pearl Harbor survivors, the Mr. Lehner I mentioned earlier. This is a man, the Chronicle covered the interview I did with him. He was on the front page of the Chronicle a couple of years ago, and he described what it was like to try to help somebody who was on fire and to get them out of the water and get the flames put out. He survived with no damage except the terrible memories that he had. He's gone now, but he's one of those survivors I was able to meet. By the way, there were many, many Muskegon survivors of Pearl Harbor. They're just about all gone, but I've discovered them in Muskegon Chronicle articles, and they're preserved in that way. There are two men who didn't make it. They were crew members of the USS Arizona. Homer Hopkins is the most famous one because his mother became the first Gold Star mother in Muskegon. In fact, she was the head of that organization during the whole war because her boy died first. Well, not exactly. Oh, by the way, the three boys were all in the war. Henry just died 3 weeks ago. He was the last one. And he's the one who told me about his older brother. And this was placed at the website of the funeral home to commemorate not only the one who just died, but the two brothers. You may never have heard of him. I was privileged a few years ago to meet his brother. And there is a nephew with his exact name today, who's probably about 55. I met his brother who said, our family was so poor. Mom was dead. All we had was dad, who didn't have a job. So my older brother, lied. He was only 16. You see, you can't go in the military when you're only 16. Of course, a lot of people sneaked in. And he said to his parents, to his father, I'm going to go in the Navy and I'm going to send all the money home to you so you can have food to eat. He was assigned to the USS Arizona. You can see that he went in 40 on Pearl Harbor Day, died instantly. So that was the sacrifice he made just so his family could survive. This picture is a really happy picture, and you're going to be really happy in a little while with a surprise at the end. But this is a group of American POWs who were kept in Japanese prisoner of war camps. I've met some prisoners who were in German prisoner of war camps, like Ken on the end. And I know they suffered, and I know it wasn't any fun at all, but they were lucky in one way. They were not prisoners of the Japanese. It was a horrible and brutal situation for them. I have never met somebody who was a prisoner of the Japanese because many of them had shorter lives. Their bodies were ruined. If they were lucky enough to come home. The thing about this joyous picture, they're in Yokohama. They're waiting at the dock for the Navy ship to come in so they can go back home, California. The man who is holding the flag is a Muskegon boy who was kept prisoner by the Japanese. And just by accident, he's in the picture holding the flag. So he's one survivor. My sister is here right now, and I'd like to refer to her because I was born during the Battle of Okinawa. The war ended. I didn't know anything, of course. I was a baby. And then came September 14th in Muskegon. Western Avenue went wild. I was there, but I don't remember it, of course. Every horn was honking. Everybody was making as much noise as they can. All the factories were blowing their whistles. And my sister, who stood, raise your hand, Doris. She was 15 years old, and she was holding her baby brother, only 2 months old, and she was so worried about me, she covered my ears to protect me from all the noise. Thanks, Doris. Now let's watch a joyful moment, because it wasn't just Muskegon that was going wild. It was every city around the world, because it was the greatest day in human history. The end of the greatest event in history, but the most horrible also. The end of World War II. Let's go to where it started, Honolulu, on VJ Day.
From the Mutual Newsroom in New York, San Francisco, the International News Service, FCC quotes, Domai saying Japan accepts allied terms. Repeating this bulletin, dated San Francisco, the Federal Communication Commission quotes Domai saying, Japan accepts allied terms. This is not official. I repeat, this is not official. This is from the Tokyo Radio. We have another bulletin here. Japan surrenders. Japan surrenders. Now repeating the entire bulletin, the Japanese government has accepted the Allied Surrender Formula.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. In that small cafe, the path across the way, the children's carousel, the chestnut trees, the wishing well. I'll be seeing you in every lovely summer's day, in everything that's light and gay, I'll always think of you that way. I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you. Everything that's light and gay, I'll always think of you that way. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, but I'll be seeing you.
I'll be seeing you. I'll be seeing you.
None of us would be here today if it not had been for you. Thank you for listening to a non-veteran who knows a few things. I hope you enjoy it. Now let's listen to the men and women who did it for us.